Raspberry Pi boards are hard to get, probably also next year. So we have to have a strategy to survive without new Raspberry boards. Sometimes a problem can be a chance. This is what we will see today. Stay tuned if you want to get a cheaper, faster, and prettier Raspberry replacement. Spoiler alert! It will be back to the future. Gritzy YouTubers, here is the guy with the Swiss accent, with a new episode and fresh ideas around sensors and microcontrollers. Remember, if you subscribe, you will always sit in the first row. Who invented it? No, not the Swiss. In my video about my Home Assistant setup, many viewers wrote that they left the Raspberries behind and went back to Intel or AMD chips. How comes? As shown in my last video, I use two Raspberry Pis, one to run Home Assistant and one for IOTstack, which contains several Docker containers like Node-RED, InfluxDB and Grafana. The viewers proposed another approach. Use a single mini PC using Proxmox. That is what we will do today. In this video, I will show you the catches I made on eBay and explain why I went this route. Install Home Assistant on the cheapest PC. Install Proxmox on bigger PCs. Install native Home Assistant on one virtual machine. And install Debian, Docker, and IOTstack on a second VM on the same PC. Compare the speed with my Raspberries. Compare the power consumption and compare the prices. Of course, we do not compare availability. The Raspberry has none. At least if you are a Patreon on this channel, you have a head start and will still find used thin client PCs on eBay. The others maybe have to wait for a little till new PCs appear on the platforms. Let's start with the hardware. Typical viewer recommendations were to use a Intel NUC with a current CPU, for example with an N5100. While this is a good choice, its price plays in a different league and its performance is also higher than needed for stuff that runs on a Raspberry. So I went the second proposed way, used thin client PCs on eBay. You find a lot of them from different brands and with different configurations. They start as low as 10 euros and go up to more than 200. So the first question is, which ones do we want to choose for what purpose? If you want to install Home Assistant, you do not need much more than the performance of a Raspberry Pi 4. 4 GB memory should be sufficient and 8 GB SSD should work too. To go the Proxmox way, you need at least 8 GB RAM and a 128 GB SSD. On my 34 euro Fujitsu with 4 GB memory and only 8 GB SSD, Proxmox did not install. You could order a used 128 GB SSD for 20 euros if you want to try Proxmox. The 4 GB RAM is the bare minimum, but okay for two VMs or a few containers. Its processor is an AMD system on a chip, which includes peripheral components to reduce cost and size. Its thermal design power is 15 watt. What does that mean? TDP is the average maximum power a processor can dissipate while running commercially available software. Generally, processors with lower TDP consume less power unless we torture them. As a rule of thumb, newer processors have smaller structures and dissipate less heat for a defined speed. For CPUs of a similar age, a low TDP usually means also low compute power. For comparison, I ordered two Lenovos, one with an i5, 4 GB memory and a 128 GB SSD. The second with an i7, 8 GB memory and 240 GB SSD. The TDP of both processors is 35 watts. Here is the CPU speed comparison based on passmarks. The Raspberry is the slowest, but because its CPU is new, it has a TDP of only 4 watt. The old i7 in comparison is 6 times faster and its TDP is 35 watt. The others are in between. We will later compare the power consumption in a real home automation scenario. The Intel N5100 is the newest CPU. It offers a similar speed to the old i5 with a TDP of only 6 watt. Not bad, also compared with a Raspberry. Unfortunately, the prices for mini PCs with this chip are pretty high. The same was true for the i5 or even the i7, by the way. We learn that the AMD will not perform well if we would use it to replace two Raspberries. For a Home Assistant server alone, it is okay. And very cheap if we compare it with a Raspberry. And here we come to an important fact. These thin client PCs are complete systems with a case, power supply, large heat sinks, and so on. Look at this beauty. The build quality is excellent because they come from the commercial market. If we add all the needed stuff to make a home server out of a Pi, we quickly end up with $150, compared with the $37 for the Fujitsu. So you know what to look for if you shop for a PC. The brand is probably not too important. I would go with a small case called USFF, sometimes called the 1 liter class. Motorcyclists like me probably would call it the 1000cc class. Why do I like them? First, they look nice. Second, they do not use a lot of space. And most important, they do not have unnecessary parts like beefy video cards, which consume power and are not used in server mode. Now we go on with the software. I promise you a good return if you stick till the end. There are quite a few small cliffs to circumnavigate on this journey. First, I will show you some tricks on installing Home Assistant on a thin client machine. They are not easy to find out. Ease of use is a significant advantage of the Raspberry Pi ecosystem, by the way. The first cliff, you cannot copy the Home Assistant image on the built-in SSD without additional hardware. If we do not want to purchase an mSATA adapter, we need to install and start a Debian live on a USB stick. I'll leave you a link to where to get it. When started, you use Firefox to install Balena Etcher on the USB stick. After starting Etcher, you input this Home Assistant download URL into the from. Select the internal SSD as a target and confirm that you want to flash it there. Now, Home Assistant is on the SSD, but unfortunately, it did not boot, at least not with my Fujitsu S920. So you need to add these commands. Now your PC should offer a new boot option called Home Assistant. Select this one and it should boot. After a few minutes, I had Home Assistant running on my cheap Fujitsu. An 8GB SSD is okay for the usual stuff. Right after the installation, we still have 66% or 4GB free disk. Results of this first finger exercise. We have replaced one Raspberry Pi for less than 40 bucks. Not bad if we consider that we bought a whole 4GB PC, not only a board. But let's continue with the real stuff. On the next machine, I will use the Proxmox virtual environment because it's open source and can be used free of charge. Or, if you want to support the project, €95 a year for one server. With Proxmox, you can run virtual machines as well as containers. Today, I will only use two virtual machines. One runs Home Assistant with its OS, and the other runs Docker and IOTstack on Debian. I choose Debian because it is close to the Raspberry OS. Installing Proxmox is a piece of cake. Still a few remarks. All my mini PCs were in PXE boot mode. As usual, I had to press the F2 or F12 key till I got into the setup menu. There I had to disable the PXE boot agent, enable all virtualization stuff as well as maximum C state support to save power, disable secure boot, adjust the boot order to boot from the internal SSD. Maybe you want to change other stuff you think is needed. For this step, a monitor with a DisplayPort connector is advised. To continue, we have two possibilities. Download the Proxmox VE installer ISO file and burn it to a USB drive using Balena Etcher. Or we copy the download URL into Etcher. I like this new and effective method. If you insert your USB dongle into a USB 3 slot of your PC and switch the power on, you should see this screen. If not, change your boot order. Hit Install, Accept, choose the internal SSD as a target, enter your country and time zone, and check the network settings. They should be okay if your PC is connected to your home network. Now hit Install and wait for a few minutes until you get the address of your newly created server. After a final reboot, your server is ready. From now on, you can detach the monitor, keyboard and mouse and use your browser. Enter the service address including the port number. It might not work right away, so check if you use HTTPS and not HTTP. If it works, you will get a warning. Continue unsafe, and finally, you can log in using the user root and your password from before. Do not care about the nagging pop-up. We will take care of it later in the video. As you can see, we created a data center with one node and two storage devices. Next, we must create our first virtual machine and install Home Assistant. Here I leave you a link on an excellent video where the Tinkerdad shows how it is done, including an essential trick for Proxmox version 7. Now we can go to the browser and connect to our newest instance of Home Assistant. Cool! Next, I want to create a second virtual machine for IOTstack. As a base, I cannot use the Raspberry OS because it would not run on an Intel platform. So I choose Debian in the AMD 64 version. It also runs on Intel processors. Again, I leave you a link to a video for the Debian installation. It is very short. Just write this guy that he should stop the music. I choose 4 CPUs and 4 GB of memory because I want both virtual machines to use all CPUs. But I'm not sure if this is right. Maybe somebody can help me understand how Proxmox deals with cores and logical processors. And of course, I name the server IOTstack and the user Pi for the feeling. Later you will see that I could have named it also SuperPi. Next, I use PiBuilder to prepare my machine. Unfortunately, copy-paste does not work in the browser, so I have to SSH into the machine. This again is not as easy as with the Raspberry Pi. We first have to include Pi in the sudo group with these commands. And start the SSH server. Now we can SSH into our server. In the first step, I tried to download PiBuilder, but before I had to install Git. Now we can download the project and run all 5 PiBuilder scripts, one after the other. No worries, the VM reboots after every script. And you have to enter the password a few times. But already now you will understand why I could have named the user SuperPi. The boot process is mind-boggling fast. If you want to use SIGPI to MQTT or Node-RED, you must do some additional steps. First, we must ensure that the SIGPI stick can be seen inside the VM. This is easy. We insert the stick into our PC, go to Proxmox Hardware and add a USB device. We select Use USB Vendor Device ID and select the dongle, in my case a Conbi2. After a reboot and lsusb, we see the stick. With this command, we get its address. Now we have to adapt these lines in the Node-RED and in the SIGPI to MQTT definitions. And we have to delete or comment these two lines because they are Raspberry specific and do not work here. After starting Docker, Home Assistant and IOTstack run without a Raspberry Pi. How cool is that? I backed up Home Assistant and IOTstack on my current machines, copied the file to my newly created Proxmox server and imported them. After that, I had my complete environment, including all historical data running in the new environment. Two questions are left. How fast are these new servers compared to the old setup, and how much power do they consume? You remember, in my last video, I complained about the slow compilation speed in ESP Home. This is why I compared the Pi with my new machines using this compilation process. Remember that compilation includes downloading some ESP repo stuff, and the CPU never exceeds 25%. Still, I think this is an actual situation. As we see, the slow Fujitsu was similar in speed. As expected, the i5 is 3 times faster, and the i7 is the fastest, but not much. But what about power consumption? To get precise measurements also in the low power area, I recently purchased this costly meter, mainly to do a future video on measuring power consumption in our homes. Here are the results. My two Raspberries consume around 12 watts, including power supplies. The Fujitsu with just Home Assistant running consumes around 14 watt, only for Home Assistant. The i5 runs at 16 to 17 watts, even during installations. It has spikes to 25, but never got below 14 watt. The i7 with double the cores runs in the same ballpark when idle, but it spikes higher than the i5. As said before, I have no N5100 PC, so I cannot judge how much it consumes. I would assume that it is below 10 watt idle, but not much because all of the other parts on the mainboard. One additional advantage of the thin client PCs. Because of their large heat sinks, they run much cooler than my Raspberry Pi. So what is the deal? Let's assume the modern processors have an average 10 watt advantage over the second-hand thin clients. The difference in 1 year is 87.6 kilowatt hours. Next year, 1 kilowatt hour costs 27 cents. So the difference is 24 Swiss francs or euros or dollars. And I pay only half the amount. Because of my PV system, I sell my electricity for half the price. For a price comparison with the current technology, I configured a new Lenovo M75 with roughly the same passmark and 8GB 128GB. It comes to roughly 5 times more than my used i5 or i7. So I think these thin clients are an excellent catch for a server. My viewers were right, and I'm happy I listened to them. Just to be precise, the Raspberries will still be used here, just not for servers. As a reward for the guys still here, I promise to show you how to switch this nagging Proxmox screen off. Go to Proxmox helper scripts. Here you will find the Proxmox 7 post-install script, where you can disable this pop-up, and many more helpers. This was all for today. As always, you find all the relevant links in the description. I hope this video was useful or at least interesting for you. If true, please consider supporting the channel to secure its future existence. Thank you. Bye.